Well, welcome. We've been waiting quite a while for this day. We're very excited to have you all here. And we actually started this process back in December when we introduced the program around Pearl Harbor Day. We always love to introduce our program then because our founder, Jack Hammett, was a Pearl Harbor survivor. So it's a perfect time for us to have all of you get ready and start our veteran assignments. For those that are new and don't really understand our program, we want you to know that while most high school students only learn their history from books, our students have the opportunity to not only learn it from their textbooks, but to hear from all of you firsthand your experiences and how you fought to defend our nation's freedom. The purpose of our program is to engage all of our students in an interactive learning process that provides them with a better understanding and a greater appreciation of our history and the sacrifices and accomplishments of our veterans. So we assigned all of our students a veteran from the Freedom Committee of Orange County, or we gave them the choice to select their own veteran. So some of you selected your mom or your grandfather or your great-great uncle, and we encouraged you to do that because what you're providing for them is this beautiful keepsake that their family will always have. So the way that this started is you start by researching your veteran's military history, and then you come up with a list of questions. And after you have the questions, you contact your veteran for the interview, and then you videotape the interview, you make a transcription of that interview, and then you write thank you letters and do a group photo. So all of that is in the folder that's in front of each veteran. And then this year, we had all of our students post their video on YouTube, and those instructions will be in your folder. And that way, anyone in your family can watch this interview, this wonderful documentary video. I stayed up late the other night and I watched a lot of them and I was really impressed. So beautiful. And I love how you mixed music and pictures and video clips and all of that into your video. So thank you so much, students, for doing that. Throughout the day, we're going to be giving many thank yous to our veterans, but I first wanted to say thank you for participating in our program and for your service. We had 91 of you participate this year and 400 students. So considering we started with 5 World War II veterans our very first year in 2000 with a panel, this is how we grew it, and it's really wonderful. Our history teachers, I wanted to say a special thank you to, if you would stand up, Mary Christensen, Chris Manning, and Bob Hiles. This program is a lot of extra work for them that's outside of their normal workload, and we really appreciate that they do all of this, go above and beyond. Wendy Gustafson, could you stand up? Is she here today? Wendy, thank you for allowing your students to participate this year and interview Sergeant Frank Orzio. We loved having your students be part of our program. Kathy Scott. Is Kathy Scott here? Yay! So I have to say that from the very beginning when I started this program to now, We have such support from our administration, and Kathy, thank you so much for so enthusiastically supporting us. PTA moms, will you raise your hands wherever you're standing, led by Candace. Where's Candace Nakamura? Candace, where are you? She's in the back. Well, we couldn't do this program without them because this, we meet like months ahead of time. We have committees. Look at this gym. It's so beautiful, as well as our ASB students who did all these beautiful posters. So thank you all to the PTA and for funding our program. We also have a huge thank you to our Newport Mesa Unified School District school board members. And if you could please stand, Karen Yelsey, Walt Davenport, Martha Fleur, Charlene Matoye, and Vicki Snell. Why don't you all stand together? 3 years ago, the school board decided to engage the Freedom Committee of Orange County to establish a living history program in all of our high schools, and we're actually in most of our junior high schools right now, too. So thank you for having the vision to do that. I don't know any other district that does this, so thank you so much. We have some neighboring principals here today. I think, Debbie, you're here. Did Michael Halt make it? I know they all had meetings. Okay, so thank you for coming, Debbie, from Back Bay. A really important part of our program is making sure our AV works, so I just want to say thank you to Tim Harris and Kyle Brooks, who's sitting right here, and they made sure that all of our sound is working great today, so thank you, guys. And finally, I want to thank Russ Williams. Would you stand up, Russ? So Russ Williams has been one of our supporters from the very beginning, from the Paskies Foundation. And what he does is he funds the lunch for all of our veterans every year. So thank you so much. If your veteran is not here today, and I appointed you your veteran, I would like you to leave that notebook on the table, and we're going to pick them up, and I'm going to make sure your veteran gets their folder. If you invited your own veteran to participate, I need you to take your veteran's folder if they're not here and make sure they get it. Thank you again. Enjoy.
Thank you, Mrs. Weiland. Our next speaker is Sergeant Frank Orzio. Sergeant Orzio is a Vietnam veteran and the founder of the Wounded Warrior Ministry. He served in the 1st Battalion, 7th Regiment of the 1st Marine Division called Suicide Charlie in the Vietnam War. Frank received 2 Purple Hearts while deployed and founded the Wounded Warrior Ministry when he returned home. It is with great pleasure that I introduce you to Sergeant Frank Orzio.
Good morning. You gotta be kidding me. You got a Marine up here. Good morning.
Good morning.
Hoorah. Semper Fi. Who knows what Semper Fi means? I need 2 people, not a veteran. 2 students. Back there. All right, come on up here for a minute. Does any girls know what that means? Any girls know what Semper Fi means? Come on up. What does it mean? Come on up and get your Starbucks cards.
Yeah,
thank you. Thank you so much. Always be prepared when you go into an event. We're into combat.
Thank you, sir.
Expect the unexpected. Know your enemy and your foe, or know those who you are fighting with. When I went to Vietnam, my cousin and I, my mother died when I was a young kid. So my aunt, my mother's sister, took me in. We became a family. My cousin and I served in Vietnam together. When we enlisted, that was the thing to do back in the 60s. That's 1960s. We thought we were going to fight for God and country. Little did we know when we got there that that would change dramatically. Each soldier here will tell you today, when you go into combat or any type of job you do in the service, you don't fight for God and country in that sense. You fight for the man on the left of you and the man on the right of you. Now, today, we have women with us, which is greatly appreciated. Everybody wants to be involved in this great nation, America. Today, I'm honored to be here with you to speak, knowing that you here today are America's future. You hold America in your hand, each one of you students. I only ask that you stay in school, get an education, go to college, because who knows, in this room today, who could be a president? Who's going to be a lawyer or a doctor or an attorney or a nurse? It has been said that the character of a nation can be measured by the way the nation treats its veterans. In every society, there are many callings. Of all of these, the path of the nation's soldier, her warriors, is the most difficult. Throughout history, the soldier has been called on to protect their country, communities, and family, and fight for others' safety and protection here and overseas. The American soldier volunteers for this duty, understanding that America is made up of many countries, many religions, which standing for freedom here. Today we are allowed to accept any religion that we want to believe in. Whoever God you pray to, that's your right as an American citizen because of the soldiers that fought for freedom in the foreign lands. No one desires peace more than us and our families, for we know that the true cost of war is those we have lost. People ask me, what is the price of freedom? People have said to me, are you a hero? And I tell them, I am not a hero, but I serve with many. I did a funeral a few years ago. But real quick, let me say this. There's a flag sitting over the left over here, the left of me on your right. That was flown in Afghanistan from sunup to sundown by my 7th Marines. I presented it today to the scout troop that is here to honor them. My Marines wanted that. I did, like I said, I did a funeral, and the little girl was standing there with her mother. She had lost her dad. The mother was holding the American flag close to her heart, like a child would hold a teddy bear. The little girl looked up at her mom and she goes, Mommy, don't cry. Daddy's home now. He's asleep inside the flag. He's one of the stars. I was very moved by that. Then she looked at me and she goes, you want to see my daddy's medals of honor? And as a soldier or even a civilian, you know that's the highest honor bestowed on any soldier for bravery and gallantry. I told her I'd love to see it. She reached in her blouse and she pulled these medals out. I looked at her and I said, honey, those are your daddy's dog tags. And with tears in her eyes, she looked, took my hand and she goes, I know, but my daddy told me anybody that fights for their God and country gets to wear these. These are the soldier's medals of honor. What a legacy for a child to hear from her dad that was killed in combat. Ladies and gentlemen, it's time to put the flag on the, back on the porch and invite God back to the dinner table in prayer. We need to talk to our families again, take America back, make her a God-fearing country once again. No matter who you believe in, this is the price of freedom here today. Remember, it's not the wind that moves the flag, but the last breath of a dying soldier. And I'm going to say a little prayer before we close. Being a pastor, that's my responsibility. Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you for our veterans. I thank you for their willingness to risk all so that our nation might dwell in peace and safety. May they find honor and recognition they deserve. In the name of your divine son, I pray you will heal the physical and psychological wounds that some of these veterans have suffered. Bring peace to those who mourn the loss of their comrades. Amen. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to close by saying one more thing. Don't forget our law enforcement officers, fire service officers, and emergency service officers. They are our first line of defense here in our homeland in the war on terror and the undeclared war on crime in our streets. God bless all of you. Thank you for being here today. Remember, you hold our future, us old guys, in your hands, and we love you. Thank you for being here.
Thank you, Sergeant Orzio, for your moving words. Now I would like to invite Brandon Getter, Mitchell Cooper, Alec Liss, and David Batchelor to present the colors and lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance. Please stand and remove your hats.
Color Guard, advance. Color Guard, prepare to pose the colors. Color Guard, pose the colors. Students, please place your right hand over your heart. Veterans, you may salute. Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. I
pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Color Guard, retreat.
Now to lead us in the national anthem, I would like to invite Jasper Ying and Andre Delgado to the podium.
So proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, were so gallantly streaming. And the rockets' red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say, does that star-spangled banner yet wave?
Spectacular job. Now, I will come around to all of the tables and ask each student leader to introduce their veteran. Group leaders, please stand with your veteran when I approach your table and state your veteran's name, rank, branch of service, and armed conflict. For example, Harry Selling was a major in the Air Force during World War II. Please hold all of the applause until the end.
Charlie Anderson was a lieutenant pilot in the Navy during World War II.
William Anderson, major in the Air Force, Vietnam War.
Jesse Apodaca, Marine in the Vietnam War.
Just Victor Bakia, Police Lieutenant, Iraq War.
Shep Bentley, Lieutenant Colonel in the United States Marine Corps, Iraqi Freedom.
Brian Burgee, a Marine, he's in Operation Iraqi Freedom.
Alan Bernstein, Navy, Korean War.
David Brooks, Sergeant in the Vietnam War.
Malcolm Campbell, Chief Warrant Officer in Army. In Vietnam.
Don Can Tran, Air Force Sergeant, Vietnam War.
Del Chase, Air Force for the Korean War.
George Ciampa, 5 campaigns in Europe during World War II.
Robert Davis, Tech Sergeant, World War II.
George Emerson, Air Force Sergeant, World War II.
James Grimm was a Chief Warrant Officer and Helicopter Pilot in Vietnam War.
Cynthia Graney, Specialist 5, Army Medic in the Vietnam War.
Richard Grabeau was a colonel in the Army during the Cold War.
Tom Gorla was a captain in Vietnam. He was in the United States Navy.
Colonel Marvin Garrison of the Marine Corps, Vietnam and Korea.
Ernesto Gakutan, aircraft mechanic, Vietnam War.
Walter Friedman, Private, World War II, Italy.
Robert Friend, Lieutenant Colonel in the Air Force in the Korean War, World War II, and Vietnam War.
This is my grandpa, Cedric Fields. He was a corporal in the Army in World War II.
Jim Eshelman, Sergeant, Air Force, World War II.
Bob Dugan, Staff Sergeant, served in the Korean War.
Jonathan Dean, Corporal in the Marine Corps, Infantry in Afghanistan War.
Gary Crest, Second Class Officer, U.S. Navy, Vietnam War.
Marshall Colt, Naval Officer, Vietnam War.
Levon Gagosian served in the United States Army Infantry from 1958 to 1960.
I'm proud to say that this veteran, Levon Gagosian, is my grandfather.
Ronnie Geyer, 1st Cavalry Radio Man, Vietnam War.
Sid Holburn, Army Sergeant in World War II and the Korean War.
Dave Hayward served in the Air Force during World War II and he achieved First Lieutenant.
Richard Hill, Marine Sergeant in the Vietnam War.
Jim Hodges, U.S. Navy Lieutenant, World War II.
Vince Howley, Army Sergeant, Vietnam.
Sergeant Edward Hubbard, Korean Air Force during the Korean War.
Major John Hughes,
United States Marine Corps, served in the Korean and World War II.
My mother, Suzanne Hughes, was a sergeant in the Army from 1980 to 1987.
Peter Katz, U.S. Army Finance Officer and Body Escort Officer, served in Vietnam and Korea.
Stanley Kielzek, 3rd Class Petty Officer, Navy, World War II.
My grandfather, Captain William Kuiper, served in Vietnam War and was in the Naval Fighter Corps.
Staff Sergeant Christopher Kupitz, United States Army, Operation Iraqi Freedom.
Jack Linscott, 2nd Class Petty Officer in World War II from 1942 to 46.
You okay, sir? Bill Moynihan, Staff Sergeant for the Air Force during the Korean War.
Jan Moorhead, Donut Dolly, USO in Vietnam.
Kent Moore, Petty Officer, 3rd Class, United States Naval Reserve in the Quemoy and Vietnam War.
Captain Ed Moore, Helicopter Pilot, Marine Corps, Vietnam War.
Semper Fi, Marines.
Douglas Milliken, Sergeant of the Army in the Vietnam War.
Edison Miller, Navy 2nd Lieutenant in Vietnam and Korean War.
John Steichermeyer, Green Beret in the Special Ops Forces in the Vietnam War.
Bob Meyer, Captain in the Army Air Corps, was a glider pilot in World War II.
Arthur Martinez, Korean War, United States Army, Colonel, 2nd Lieutenant.
Frank Menino, boatswain in the Navy in World War II.
Sergeant Vern Martin, Army Air Corps, World War II, serving in China.
William Maul, Major General in the Air Force during the Vietnam War, and Operation Urgent Fury.
Bob Longman, Korean War, 3rd Class Petty Officer, Navy SEAL.
Dick O'Brien, Sergeant, U.S. Army, 35th Infantry Division, Patton's 3rd Army, World War II.
Robert Old served as a captain in the Navy during the Vietnam War and the Cold War.
Frank Orzio, Vietnam War Sergeant in the Marine Corps.
Donald Pogler served as 2nd Class Crypto Technician in the Six-Day War.
Frank Pangborn, 1st Air Cavalry, 1st Lieutenant, Vietnam War.
Jim Payne, Air National Guard and Navy Reserve, Cold War.
Bill Pemberton, U.S. Navy, the Cold War.
Clayton Peterson, Military Police in World War II, who unfortunately can't be here today because he passed away.
Conrad Rapp, Spec 5 in the U.S. Army, served in the Vietnam War.
Harel Rush, Sergeant in the Israeli Army, and he fought in the Gaza War. And he can't be here today because he's studying at Syracuse University.
Bob Ruiz, B-24 Liberators of World War II in the Air Force.
Casey Rujewski, U.S. Army Infantry, served in Afghanistan.
Major Haman Sally, Special Forces and U.S. Army Infantry, Vietnam War.
Chase Wickersham, First Lieutenant, Army Artillery, Vietnam War.
Fred Whitaker was a 12th Division Infantryman in World War II. Fred Whitaker was a 12th Division Infantryman in World War II.
Robert Wiegand, he was Navy SEAL officer as mission planner in the Gulf Wars. Fortunately, he's not here today because he's pretty busy.
Buck Wall, Staff Sergeant in the U.S. Air Force during the Cold War.
Philip Vinci, second class machinist mate in the Navy in World War II.
Mario Vinci, Lieutenant, served from 1943 to 1946 in the Pacific and Atlantic Coast and fought in World War II.
And I want to thank you all for attending this meeting. You took time off from your daily program to honor us. I thank you.
Michael Trerotola, Lieutenant Commander, Navy, World War II.
My grandfather, Jasper Tamborello, served as a sergeant for the U.S. Marines during the Korean War.
Ted Tanner, who fought in the Air Force in World War II.
Mel Spies, a Major General in the Marines during the Iraq War.
Stephanie Soltis, a major in the Air Force during the War of Terror.
My grandfather, Kosti Sherbanian, who was a corporal medic in the Korean War.
Harry Selling, major Air Force in World War II.
Bill Schultz, aviation electronics technician, second class Navy. World War II and the Cold War.
Irving Sanders, Staff Sergeant, U.S. Marines, fought World War II in the Pacific.
George Woodley, Sergeant in the Navy in the Korean War.
Sandy Wilford, a lieutenant in World War II for the Air Force.
First Lieutenant Scott Williams served in the Army in Vietnam.
I'd like to introduce Mr. David Lester. He fought in the World War II as well as the Korean War, and he was a combat Army engineer, and he fought in the Battle of the Bulge. Okay, also I'd like to introduce Mr. Mitchell. He fought in the Korean War and the Cold War.
My name's Bill Caldwell, and I served in Vietnam in 1968.
Yeah, Captain Tim Richards, Army Corps of Engineers, Korea, Vietnam, and the Cold War.
I'm Bill Stewart, served at the end of World War II, recalled to the Korean War and the Cold War in that period in 52.
Let's give these veterans the applause they've earned. Our student slideshow editor, Danielle Bentley, will now present the slideshow. Thank you.
Wonderful job on the slideshow, Danielle. It is with great respect that I introduce to you Mr. Scott Williams, a Vietnam veteran and president of the Freedom Committee of Orange County.
I have my goodie bag here, so allow me one moment. My name is Scott Williams, the president of the Freedom Committee of Orange County. The Freedom Committee was founded for the purpose to enhance education through personal history stories of those who served honorably in the armed forces of the United States of America. All of our veterans have been looking forward to this event. Some have postponed vacations to be here. Some postponed medical appointments and operations to be here. And unfortunately, a few are on the benefit list and unable to attend. But they all appreciate what this school does with the students, the administration, and the Board of Trustees. I think I can speak for all the veterans present here today when I say thank you. Thank you very, very much. Corona Del Mar should be so proud of its students' participation and contributions to this great living history program. For me, I would like to personally thank Jacob Cooper, Jacob Humbert, Charles Jacobs, and Joseph Rosencieto for the time they took to interview me. A special thanks to Principal Kathy Scott and the teachers of Corona Del Mar School for making this Living History Luncheon possible. I'd like to acknowledge Mary Christensen, Bob Hiles, Chris Manning, and Wendy Gustafson. And we have certificates of appreciation for the teachers and for the principal, Kathy Scott. And I've delivered to them a packet which contains our newsletter. It contains the surrender copy of the surrender document of the Japanese, and it contains the ship's record of the USS Maryland from December 7th, 1941, from 0-100 hours to 2400 hours, which was contributed by one of our World War II veterans. The Freedom Committee of Orange County would also like to thank Denise Weiland, a Freedom Committee associate liaison, for her efforts in managing and coordinating this Veterans Appreciation Luncheon year after year. It is especially important after the passing of Jack Hammett, who had promised us all that he would spend another 5 years training us to follow in his footsteps. This program has been adopted in each of the district's 6 high schools and some middle schools, and other school districts in other counties are also following in the footsteps of the Corona Del Mar's leadership, and this has made it easier for these districts. The Freedom Committee of Orange County began as a panel program in 1998, which, my math is correct, was 18 years ago, with 5 members, and one of the members, founding members, Dave Lester, is here today, and I'd like to acknowledge Dave is on table number 6. And I'd also recognize the person who came in a little bit later. Where's Sid? Okay, Sid. The other 4 are part of the many members who have carried their own living history into eternity, including our founder, World War II veteran, and Pearl Harbor survivor, Jack Hammett. Our nearly 120 combat veterans are invited to schools throughout Orange County, Los Angeles, Riverside, and San Bernardino counties, and have spoken to more than 110,000 students, bringing the Freedom Committee of Orange County's living history into the classrooms and auditoriums. They take their time to sit with our younger generation to pass on the experiences so the lessons may be learned for making future decisions. The Freedom Committee meets the second Wednesday of each month at the Costa Mesa Neighborhood Community Center for special personal history presentations by one of our veterans. The meeting is open to the public. Also, the Freedom Committee of Orange County will be coordinating the 62nd annual Memorial Day services at Harbor Lawn Mount Olive Memorial Park in Costa Mesa on Monday, May 30th, 2016 at 11 a.m. As we go forward into the next school year, we are planning to have a student essay contest and a reward for the best essay, which we are working on right now and would like to meet with the teachers to kind of give their final stamp. It would reward you with a financial stipend and history books relating to our mission. Also, we publish a quarterly newsletter, which we will do our best to send out to all of the principals and teachers so that they can keep abreast of what we're doing. In closing, I would like to say I am always humbled and honored to be in the presence of our veterans. Even though their stories speak to the harsh realities and emotions of war, their tears are for their buddies who paid the ultimate price in battle. We continue our job of passing on the torch of liberty to future generations. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Williams. For the students who will now be sharing their reflections, please come forward. Veterans may remain seated.
Hello, fellow students, teachers, staff, and veterans. I'm Grace Hatchigan. Welcome to the 2016 Living History Luncheon. We've all heard the word sacrifice, but what does it mean? It is what this country was built on. The blood, sweat, tears, and many lives dedicated to protect our nation's values are a direct reflection of the tremendous sacrifices United States veterans have made for us. Many men and women have devoted their lives to maintaining this country's reputation of being the best in the world. But there would be no United States of America if it weren't for the countless lives of men and women who sacrificed themselves to make it so. I would like to thank all of the brave veterans here today for protecting our country and giving us freedom. We have all heard the quote, "Freedom is not free." Many servicemen and women have paid the ultimate sacrifice for our freedom. The veterans here today have witnessed acts of indecency that we can't even imagine. It is because of the courageous soldiers who fought for us that we were all born into this country with freedom and certain unalienable rights. It is because of them that we get to live in one nation under God, where there is liberty and justice for all. And it is under them that we get the ability to not only live, but to thrive in the land of the free and the home of the brave. We are the free because they were the brave. This history project let me not only appreciate the tremendous sacrifices our veterans have made for us, but also taught me to not take for granted the gift of freedom and protection. I would like to end by saying to all the veterans here today, thank you so much for everything you have done to ensure this country's safety and liberty. On behalf of my sophomore class, I would like all of you to know that even though we may be millennials and futuristic thinkers, we will never forget what you have done for us and will always respect and be forever grateful for your service. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Isaac Clark, and I would like to thank all the veterans who were able to make it here today, and I would like to thank them for their service. I had the honor and pleasure of interviewing Major General Mel Spies, who, as a Marine, Major General Spies earned many honors, some of which include the Navy Distinguished Service Medal, the Defense Superior Service Medal, 3 Legions of Merit, the Joint Meritorious Service Medal, not one, but 3 Navy and Marine Corps Commendation Medals, as well as the Joint Service Achievement Medal. My interview with Mel shed light into the organization of the Marine Corps and the recent history of the United States. Major General Spies is a very accomplished and impressive veteran. I wish you were able to be here today so I could introduce him to you. The Living History Project was a very interesting and exciting experience that I certainly will remember many years after I have graduated from CDM. I would like to thank Mrs. Weiland for giving us sophomores this opportunity to learn firsthand what these veterans have experienced, and I would like to thank my veteran, Mel Spies, for sharing his distinct story and his experiences with us. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Brooke, and I feel that the Living History Project is a once-in-a-lifetime experience. Rather than reading historical facts, we are fortunate enough to meet with those who made history. My group and I had the pleasure of interviewing World War II veteran Dave Hayward. Mr. Hayward flew B-25s in China, Burma, and India during World War II and shared his experiences with us that shape his life today. At one point in time while he served, Mr. Hayward saw his life flash before him. Just yards away from a Japanese fighter plane, Mr. Hayward wasn't sure if he would live another day. He remembers looking over and seeing the Japanese pilot and thinking that that pilot was probably just like him. He probably had a family back home and had left the ones he loved to fight for his country. Not many people can say that they've experienced a time where they were unsure if they would make it out alive, and now that Mr. Hayward has, he has a unique outlook on life. His philosophy is, you can't change the past. You can wish that things were different, but in reality, they aren't. Mr. Hayward feels it is important to move on and focus on the blessings in our daily lives because we never know when they will be taken away. Thank you, Mr. Hayward, for teaching my group and I a lesson that we couldn't have learned from our textbook.
Good afternoon. My name is Laurel Foster. The way in which veterans tell their life stories has always had a certain surprising element to me. They don't do it with a sigh and a surface consideration of what they have done, as most of us might when asked what we have accomplished in our life. They respond with a sort of selfless pride, the humble confidence that is characteristic of someone who has set aside their life for humanity as a whole. In my conversation with John Stryker Meyer, I was brought to consider how little I think of the servicemen in my daily life, though they may be thinking of me, the common American, every day as they fight to protect the values I hold close to my heart, but so often take for granted. It was not until talking to Mr. Meyer that the idea of war jumped out of the pages of the textbooks and became something real and tangible. In stories told in under an hour and a half, I learned more about war than I had in any textbook I've ever read. Thank you, Mr. Meyer, for reminding me of my late grandpa, a lieutenant commander in the Navy, who told the most vibrant and intriguing stories about his service in World War II. The bravery you exhibited in your years of service and the pride and conviction in your cadence reminded me of listening to him as a little girl, feeling patriotic and proud of my country for the first times. I will never forget your wartime stories and the overall experience of meeting you. I am so grateful for being granted an hour and a half of your time. To all the veterans here today, you have inspired me in more ways than you can know. Thank you once again for all you have done and your service to our country. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. Our veteran was my cousin, Harrell Rush, and he was a sharpshooter and a sergeant in the Israeli Army. He served in the Army for about 2 years, and he fought in the Gaza War and defended Israel's border. Unfortunately, he can't be here today because he's at Syracuse University studying, but if he were here today, I just want to tell him thank you so much for risking his life to fight for a country and a home for the Jewish people, and I tell him thank you so much for giving up your time to do an interview with us. To me, this interview was really special because I hadn't seen Harrell since he left for the Army. Also, the interview was the first time where I really got to have a long conversation with him, and I felt that it was a great experience for me and him because we both got to know each other better as cousins. Also, this experience was very eye-opening for my group members and myself because we learned so much about the conflict in Israel and between the Palestinians. For example, none of us knew that the precautions that the Israelis take to avoid civilian casualties, such as warning an entire city when they're going to bomb or attack them, which gives the enemies an advantage, but they don't want to risk the lives of the civilians there. So once again, I just want to thank Harrell, and I want to thank all the veterans here for giving up your time to do this project with us. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Sarah Duart. Last Tuesday, my great-great-uncle and World War II veteran, Clayton Peterson, passed away at the age of 92.
Clayton was a brilliant man and inventor who continued to create all sorts of things that we continue to use today well into his old age. Prior to my group's interview with him for our project, Clayton had called my grandmother and expressed to her how nervous he was to talk with us about his experiences in World War II. But he was a natural storyteller and made us all feel so comfortable while he was talking about such a hard time in history. Clayton then called my grandmother again after our interview and told her how much this project had meant to him. He said he thought that our generation didn't care about World War II veterans anymore, and he was astonished to see how much we all wanted to hear his story and learn about him as a person. This project gave me the chance to get to know my great-great-uncle before he passed away, and I am so humbled to be able to stand here today in Clayton's honor with the opportunity to graciously thank all of the other veterans in this room for their service to our country. So thank you all, and God bless America.
Good afternoon, my name is Jillian Hughes. Army Strong. Two words you wouldn't normally associate with an HR representative at a small dental company in Irvine. But after interviewing my mother, Suzanne Hughes, for this project, I have learned that these words are a more than accurate description of her. And no, she never shot anyone, or drove a tank, or flew a fighter jet, or even fought in a war. But despite only serving during peacetime, my mother got to travel the country, help thousands of patients, and learn her way around an operating room, all the while being on call for duty. So if there's one thing I've learned, it's that not every soldier is on the front lines taking shots at the enemy. Many remain unsung heroes, the ones who help the wounded and make sure that those troops who are on the front lines have the training and equipment they need. All the veterans in this room today, regardless of the wars they did or didn't fight in, have worked and fought tirelessly in defense of our nation and deserve our highest respect. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Ryan Zahed, and it was a pleasure to interview veteran Harry Selling, who served in World War II as a pilot. And now before I say a few words about Mr. Selling, I'd like to thank all of our guest veterans here for their service to our great nation. Every single one of our guests has attributed to the United States goal of attaining freedom, and we are very thankful for their work. Our mentoring veteran, Mr. Selling, is a remarkable individual who's gracious enough to share his stories with us, and we are incredibly thankful for being able to interview him. It was very interesting to hear about his work flying a B-17 bomber and learning about his time as a POW after being shot down in World War II. His recounts were very gripping, and he described everything from his fellow airmen to his time in a German POW camp. Also, hearing his experiences as a civilian working in the lumber industry after the war was incredibly interesting and very motivational. He was even kind enough to talk to us individually about our own lives and talents and how we can manage our futures and a few keys to success for daily life. And I think that's enough to show what a kind man Mr. Selling is. Like when we're interviewing him, so he takes us out of our interview to talk to us individually about how our lives and how we could influence our futures. My fellow classmates and I were very lucky to be able to listen and learn from our veterans, as you all gave us information that can't be provided by a textbook. And we are all very thankful for your willingness to educate us. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Bobby Percival, and I interviewed Ted Tanner. We are free. We are free because you are a veteran. You are the one who has protected us through good times and bad, protected the freedom of the United States, the freedom I'm thankful for every day. Our freedom wasn't just handed to us, but earned through hard work, dedication, and bravery from our veteran. These qualities come to my mind when I think of our veteran. You made hard sacrifices I don't think I can ever make. You left all your friends and family to fight in foreign lands with strangers you barely knew. You defended us through hardship, struggle, and lack of resources. But you pushed through these obstacles in order to come back to see your friends and family again. They were your drive. That is why you didn't give up. You knew in your mind that you needed to see them again. This act of bravery is appreciated by the people of the United States. You risked your own life just to save others. I don't think I can even imagine what you did. I respect you for everything you did for our nation. You endured boot camps, war, harsh weather, and more. You were willing to sacrifice yourself for others. Some people don't understand why we have Veterans Day or say why it's not that important. It is most important because they have protected you when you didn't even know it. They are the reason we have the freedom that we do. I won't want to live in a country where I have no freedoms, but because of what you did, I don't worry about that anymore. For all the sacrifices you have made for our country, you have represented the red, white, and blue greatly. When we had the opportunity to visit you, I realized that I was about to meet a real hero. When I went home to reflect back on the stories and couldn't stop thinking about how brave you were. Thank you for all you did. You truly are the best veteran.
Good afternoon. My name is Parker Hoffman, and my veteran is George Ciampa. He served as a private in the 607th Grave Registration during World War II and was involved in 5 significant military campaigns, including Battle of the Bulge and D-Day. Having the ability to interact and learn about the war from him has taught me so much and greatly impacted me personally. Compared to watching a video or reading a textbook, speaking with a veteran amplifies the emotional part of the war that tends to be lost in print. Mr. Ciampa's tales of friendship, luck of evading death, tending to the dead, and the stench that he still remembers gave me insight to what these veterans really experience when fighting for their country. Having this opportunity to get a glimpse into the past by interviewing Mr. Ciampa and listening to his most memorable experiences, observing his war collection of weapons, uniforms, and photographs, in addition to viewing his self-produced and directed documentaries, has really demonstrated the strength and courage needed for battle. We are privileged to hear his stories and have them documented, to learn from, to study, to remember. Future generations will have firsthand recollections of the war after the passing of this generation of heroes, so we don't forget. Mr. Ciampa, thank you for your patriotism, your heroism, and your sacrifice. It's been an honor to meet you. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Michael Kuiper. I have the honor and privilege of introducing my grandfather, Captain William Kuiper. My grandfather served in the Vietnam War as a naval fire pilot in Squadron 111, otherwise known as the Sundowners. There, he flew the FJ-3 Fury, traveling almost everywhere in Southeast Asia and in Iraq. My grandfather served for 14 years in total, and including in the US Navy Reserves. From interviewing him, he has instilled in me a greater understanding of life in war and has fascinated me with his stories and his experiences, for which I am truly grateful for. One example of one of his great stories is when he had to eject out of his plane in the middle of the Pacific Ocean, and as he was coming down, he looked and he saw a plane in the distance. At first he felt happy because he thought it was someone coming to get him after he ejected, but then he later realizes that there was no one in the plane. It turns out that the plane he ejected out of kept on going, made a 360-degree turn, descended at the same rate he was, and as he put it, if he was any closer, he could have touched the wingtip. Overall, I'm very glad to have had the chance to interview my grandfather, Captain William Kuiper, and it's been an honor and privilege. And to those others who have also served, I thank you.
Hi, my name is Nick Panessa, and first off, I just want to thank all of the veterans and Ms. Weiland for putting this together. My veteran, Jeff Kimberlin, he's an E5 in electronic warfare in Vietnam, and what he told me really changed my eyes about like how good we have it today. He got drafted the day after he graduated high school. So that really just made me rethink like the actions I've made before and like how what I'll do to better myself, because you never know when you can be drafted or a war will break out. Overall, this experience really just opened my eyes and made me a lot better person. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Emmy Rolfes. To all the veterans who could join us here today, I would like to say thank you for your service to our country and for spending time with us to share your amazing stories. We are extremely lucky to have the opportunity to get to know you and have been touched by your personal experiences. It was very special because we got to learn history firsthand from your perspective and to understand your love and passion for our country. We hope that you continue to share your stories with others. We will always cherish the time that we spent with you and remember this experience forever. The Living History Project was a great project to work on and helped make history fun, exciting, and very interesting. We hope to see you all next year. I will also like to thank Ms. Weiland for continuing to do an amazing job organizing this project and luncheon, and to all the PTA moms who are helping to make this a very special day for the veterans and us. Thank you.
Thank you, students. I would now like to welcome Corona Del Mar High School's principal, Ms. Kathy Scott, to the podium.
Good afternoon. As the principal of Corona Del Mar High School, I can't express how much pride it brings to not only us as a school, but to me personally as a principal to be a part of such an amazing project. And I can assure Denise Wallen, I'm not sure where she stepped off to, and Scott, the chairman of the Freedom Committee, that we will continue this partnership for a long time. This is a life-impacting learning experience that is invaluable. And to students, I want to say thank you for taking this project seriously. I want to ask that hopefully your inspiration and motivation, encouragement has led you to think about what kind of citizen you will grow up to become as you continue through your teenage and young adult years, that you have been inspired to become a service leader, just as your veterans that you interviewed, you saw their selfless service they gave to our country, that you will be inspired to follow that example. And to our veterans, I want to say thank you for not only your selfless service in the past, but what you've done recently for our students. This is truly a passing of the torch, as our picture depicts, of you passing one generation to another. And your lives not only made a difference historically, but it's making a difference in the future. And as we live in rather turbulent times right now, we can be assured that we have a great and bright future because of the past connecting with our present and making a future a reality for us that will be safe and free. So I want to thank you all. As we close, I want to invite Vince Halley to the front at this time. Vince will play taps in memory of those who have fallen and in honor of all of you who are here serving with us today. Thank you, Vince.
Thank you, Mr. Howley. That was very touching. This concludes our Living History Luncheon. Upon dismissal, students, please return to fifth period. Veterans, please come forward to the flag for a group picture. Thank you, everyone, for attending, especially our guest veterans. It is with the utmost respect that I salute you all. God bless America. You are now dismissed.